Most physical objects in everyday life maintain the same identity whether we're interacting with them or not. Like, a baseball is a baseball whether you're holding it in your hand or it's flying through the air. Even electrons are electrons whether they're part of an atom or flying freely through interstellar space. They have the same mass, same charge, they are electrons. But neutrinos, those weird super light, super fast, electrically neutral, hard to interact with particles, they are identity agnostic. Neutrinos have different identities depending on whether they're interacting with other particles or traveling freely, and on top of that, their identities can change over time. Here's what I mean. When they interact with other particles, like when they're produced in fusion in the sun or in radioactive decay, there are three different kinds of neutrinos, characterized by the particles involved in their creation or annihilation. And when they're traveling through space, there are three different kinds of neutrinos, characterized by their masses. But these two sets of identities don't match up in a one-to-one correspondence. Instead, each of the interaction identities is actually a unique mix of the three traveling identities. And this weirdness allows neutrinos to change their identities. That's because the traveling identities have different masses, so they travel differently from each other. Technically, what happens is they each pick up a complex numbered phase depending on their mass and how far they've traveled, but we'll just show that with arrows that rotate at different speeds, which is essentially the same thing. Anyway, because the arrows rotate at different speeds, over time, a combination that initially looked like an electron interacting neutrino might become the muon interacting combination. And then if you wait longer, the combination will look like an electron interacting neutrino again, then muon interacting, and so on, back and forth. All happening as the neutrino flies super fast through space. It's kind of like if I took my violin and played an A, and somehow by the time the sound waves reached your ear, the relative strengths of the frequencies had shifted, so you heard the sound as an E, or a D, or an A, depending on how far away you were. In fact, the oscillation of neutrinos back and forth between different identities was discovered in part because we didn't see as many neutrinos coming from the sun as our understanding of fusion suggested. It turned out that about two-thirds of the electron interacting neutrinos had turned into muon and tau interacting neutrinos en route to the Earth, in what turned out to be a very real, very long-range example of quantum superposition. Oh, and one other little technicality. Even though the three interaction neutrinos are named after the specific electron family particles that are involved in their creation and annihilation, they can still interact with, or bounce off of, other members of the electron family, as well as the quarks. Okay, I'd like to thank the Heising-Simons Foundation for their support of this video and of neutrino research. They put me in touch with some of the neutrino researchers they help fund, who were awesome to talk to and learn from. And the Heising-Simons Foundation also funds a variety of research in other fields, like exoplanets, microscale gravity, dark matter, climate change, and so on. To learn more about the Heising-Simons Foundation, check out heisingsimons.org. Thanks.